So
Sorry,
they will be
go ahead.
given crop insurance or other kinds of assistance to agriculture. So that's where the definition of drought comes into play. Now, there is a, if you follow the news closely, I mean, not the mainstream media, but the other articles around drought, which are doing quite a bit of analysis, you will very soon realize that this monsoon is going to be a very good monsoon. The coming monsoon this year throughout the country and pretty much all the states will be a very good monsoon. This is as per the current weather predictions. Now, that could be a good news, but that's also a very bad news because this is probably the first time in maybe a decade or more where at least drought has become a very serious issue that there's also a lot of interest. There's also a lot of awareness, and there's also a lot of media coverage that has been going on. So what will happen with the monsoon is once the monsoon starts, the government and the media and everybody will slowly start, receding from their whatever interest and awareness or analysis they have been doing. All that will be sort of pulled back or slowed down, if not completely died down. Because now the monsoon is good and people will be talking about, okay, what is my next harvest going to be? How is this year's crop production going to be? And that's where the danger lies. So it's very important that in these 2 or 3 months, the continuous focus is made on drought and also to see how best we can sort of exploit the situation that there is a serious drought. Let's do whatever it takes so that we can take care of this situation in such that tomorrow or 5 years from now, when there's a similar drought-like condition exists, at least whatever precautions we take will come in handy. So the next 3, 4 months are really key for us to really do something about it. Now I have the join the sharing session. If you guys are sitting in front of a computer, if you can go to join.me, if you can type it in either whatever browser you have, then I can give you the code using which you can sort of see my screen.
Hey, Shrinker, would you be able to update that on the Facebook?
Yeah, I'll
Right.
give the link to, I'll update it on Facebook actually. Let me do
Okay,
that.
thank you. Appreciate that a lot. Thank you.
Yeah.
Is
I
it
think
join
there's an
dot me?
app also for that. Yes, there is an app as well.
Okay. Looks like we
Is it
need
join
to.
dot me? I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yes, it's join.me. And I'll be sharing the link on the Facebook page, the event page that Shrikar created. Give me just 1 second. Okay, here.
It's asking for join me ID.
Yeah, that's the one that I'm going to share.
Okay.
Okay, I posted. You guys should be able to click that and let me know if you're able to see my screen.
Hi, can you give me the code actually?
Sure, I'll read it out. It's 703 hyphen 08, sorry, yeah, 703 dash 087 418.
I repeat, 703 hyphen 087 418.
Yeah, 087 hyphen 418.
Yeah, thanks.
Let me know if anybody tried to join using that ID and are able to see my screen.
Can you please repeat it once more?
We are able to.
Yeah, I'm able to
join. All right, awesome. I can see four people in there. So the ID again is 703-087-418. 703-087-418. And I think even without the hyphen, it should work.
Yeah, it's automatically filling out the hyphen.
Yeah, it is automatically populating the hyphen.
What should be the password?
There is no password, I think.
There is no password. Actually, as soon as you enter the like passcode and enter join, we can see his monitor.
Yeah, there is no password for this.
I think there is like a start meeting and join meeting. Probably if you click join meeting, it will just ask for the code.
Yeah, I have seven people, and I think there's a limit. Probably it only allows 10 because it's a free version, I guess. So, Shrikar, we have more than 10 people on the call, or?
Yeah, we have 12 people. So we have 11 actually. I can drop out. That's fine. If it blocks out someone, let's do that. Yeah.
All right.
It's just going in circles for me. I mean, it's not logging in.
Okay, I mean, I will also make it, while I'm explaining this, I'll also make it, even without the sharing, you should be able to follow what I'm trying to do. So in the interest of time, can I get started? Feel free to stop me if you don't follow, and then we can try something else.
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. So... So let's say now we want to look at what the government data is, or what are our politicians thinking about, and what are their plans and how they want to manage the drought and so on and so forth, right? So, there are probably many ways to get this information. But unfortunately, there is no single website where we can see all the different government departments and their links and everything. Actually, this is a link I'm still compiling, and I've got about 20 or 30 odd websites, but I haven't finalized it, so I haven't published it yet. So what I typically do is I go into loksabha.nic.in. That's loksabha.nic.in. And under there, if you can see here, there is a menu for questions, and then I go into questions search, right? So once you click on quest,
Suresh.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you. Are you recording this session?
Yeah.
Is there an option? Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, the conference is being recorded. Yeah.
Okay. Conference is being recorded. Okay.
Yeah, not the screen sharing session. I don't think I can share. I can record that unless somebody thinks that's possible. I don't think so. But
No problem. Sorry to interrupt you. Please go ahead.
No problem. So once under questions, if you click on question search, then you will get into this menu. Now here, what I typically do is I type in drought, and I say I want to search in the entire text of any of these discussions. Now, whatever questions you're seeing here, these are the questions raised by the members of parliament. And if you click on the link, it's going to show you, what was the question and what was the response that the corresponding minister, the respective minister, has given to that particular question. So what I'm saying here is I want to search on drought. I want to search in the full text of the answer or the discussion, not just the title of the question. And then I want to search any match. I don't want to say exact word, but I want to say any words that come up with drought. And this is, I learned it by experience that this is, by doing so, you will get the best match. And then if you do search, it'll show up, it'll pull back whatever results it'll find. And note that this is only going to pull back from the Q&A session for this, the 16th Lok Sabha, right? But for the previous ones, if you see here, there is archive sections where you can go back and search on these two. So if you want to see what the UPA government did, and even before that, so there is also our archival information that's present on the left-hand side of the menu, right? So it's still searching for the information, so hopefully it should come back. In the meanwhile, I'll show you something that I, as part of my analysis I was doing in my blog, I think a few months ago, no, maybe last week or the week before that. Here.
So, Suresh, a quick question.
Yeah.
Who actually contributes this data for this website?
I mean, this is the Look server actually maintains all this information. There are probably some personnel who are recording all this information and maintaining digitally.
So is it like the ruling government, or is it like an agency which stays forever irrespective of the government?
I mean, that we don't know whether they outsource this or somebody is part. I think it's somebody part of the, they're probably employees of the Lok Sabha or whoever is responsible for maintaining these websites.
Okay.
They are probably given this responsibility. So there is no translation gap or anything. Whatever is being discussed on the floor of the house, you will exactly see the same wordings on this question and answer session.
Okay, great, thanks.
Right. So if you see here, now we got 29 pages. In some cases, it could be some overwhelming, but we can also see how we can navigate that. So we got 29 hits for the search keyword drought, right? Now, if you can see here, this, yeah.
Sorry to disturb, but would you be able to maximize the screen and increase the font?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
No, it's good, thank you.
You can actually do it in the right-hand bottom in your own computer if it's not scaled up to your screen. Yeah.
I'll go try that too.
Is it good?
Just try to move the pointer. You'll see an option in the bottom of the right.
Okay.
Is this good? Are you able to see it properly now?
Oh, yeah, it's almost good. Yeah, this much better. Thank you.
Okay. So what I then do is I look at the subject. The subject gives us some insight into, okay, what kind of question was asked and whether this is relevant for what I'm trying to do, right? So here I already see that there are some things that could be of interest to us. It says mechanism to deal with disasters. Now, this is a very broad subject. They're not talking about drought alone, but they're talking about many other disasters, and maybe inside this, a drought has been mentioned. And if you see the ministry, this is a space ministry. So we know that while it talks about drought, it may not be entirely relevant, right? Then you switch to causes of droughts, and this is from the agriculture and farmers' welfare. So this looks to be a more relevant topic for us, right? So let's look into what this guy is saying. All right. So here, the minister asked the question, saying whether droughts in the country are caused due to changing crop patterns. If so, what are the details? Whether government has identified reasons which cause frequent droughts, and what steps the government is taking to deal with the drought situation. So they have given a pretty elaborate, answer. And sometimes they also provide a lot of data to go with this answer. So what I do is I read quickly here. What it's saying is drought is due to soil moisture, blah, 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 no rainfall, no irrigation facilities and everything. And they say that, okay, these are the different kinds of departments they have set up, which are supposed to be, monitoring the drought situation and employing the necessary drought management things to, get the drought under control, or at least have some systems in place which will better equip the states to deal with the drought situation, right? Now, if I go back in here, so this is how we got into by just clicking on this. Now, if you look at the PDF Word, these are attachments. One is in English, obviously the other one is in Hindi. If you look at this PDF document, what happens is anytime there is additional data that the answer requires, they usually provide in the PDF documents. So if you open up the PDF documents, I'm sure we'll be able to find one example. It'll also show you data saying, okay, these are all the states where the drought exists, and this is how much of money the different departments have spent, or this is how much of money the individual states have asked the center, but the center only gave like 60 or 70% of that money. Now, this is an analysis that I did based on the Lok Sabha information that I got. And
does that also mention how much did they give to each state in response of what they've asked? Okay.
Yeah, you'll have all that information. So here, if you see, this is just, you know, one part of what I've managed to put it in my blog. It's not the complete picture, but what I've tried to capture here is there are enough material published on the government websites which talk about drought management, what needs to be done, the preparedness plans you see here, and also the preventive measures here, and what is each department doing. So they have pretty elaborate, monitoring, preparedness, mitigation, response, and then the forecasting and what are the different, administrative things that each one of these guys, departments do, and so on and so forth. Now, if you go straight up, you will see that these are all the states where drought has been prevalent. And if you see the number here, this represents the number of districts within each state where there is drought. So it's clearly saying that in Uttar Pradesh, we have 75 districts. In Telangana, you have 10 districts. Jharkhand, 24. Madhya Pradesh, 42. So it's pretty severe. It's not like one or two districts in each state. And then this is just one. So like I said, In the question and answer, we saw that there are a lot of these different departments which are involved in drought management. Now, what I'm representing here is there is the NDRF, which is like the National Disaster Response something. I forget what it is. But if you see here, the state requested the NDRF for these many, if you take Karnataka, 3,800 crores of assistance. But what was released by the expenditure department was around 1,540 crores. So you can see the total requested was 40,000 crores, but what was disbursed was just 2,700 crores, right? And likewise, there is also the other day I was looking at it. If I go into other desalination plans, I just want to share one other important information, and then we can jump into how to collect this data and how to make sense of this information. Come on. The website obviously is very slow, so sometimes it takes like a minute or so to load. Right. Here, misuse of groundwater, storage capacity of reservoirs. Yeah, this was also a pretty good document. The storage capacity of reservoirs, I think overall in India, we have about some 91 to 100 reservoirs. So these are status of present reservoir storage as on 2016 compared to average of last 10-year storage. Now, if you see here, Himachal Pradesh has two reservoirs that are being monitored. Last 10 years average was 3.61. The current was 2.6. So there was a drop of almost 28% in there. And if you see this column, interestingly enough, every single state, there is a decline. Telangana, 48. AP and Telangana, of course, that's because of the split here. Chhattisgarh, 25. Uttarakhand, 67. Maharashtra, 60. Tripura, this number is skewed a little bit because there's only like one reservoir. So there's not much happening there. So that's why this is a bit skewed. But if you see everything else, pretty much all the reservoirs are also indicating clearly that there is a significant decline in the water that they are able to store. And if you think a bit more deeper, this is not like happened in 1 year that there's a 28% reduction in Himachal Pradesh or 47% reduction in Punjab, right? It has been happening pretty much every single year, but we have completely ignored or neglected that fact that, hey, there is a serious problem. And all that in the last 10 years meant that the cumulative effect now, as of 2016, is like 28-47. So we made things worse by not doing anything. But that's what this document is telling us. So while this data is giving, this is simply the question and answer. Now, if you see here, the question that was asked was whether the government monitors live storage of the reservoirs, if so, the details thereof, blah, blah, blah. So nowhere in here, the minister actually, or at least this is not recorded in these Q&A sessions, that why isn't the government, or the previous government for that matter, has not done anything knowing fully that you guys are monitoring these reservoirs, you have clearly seen the decline, but why is there no action being done? So our exercise essentially is to interpret the data along those lines. Now, we have the data right sitting in front of us and staring at us. And if you see the number of reservoirs in the country as a whole is 91. The total capacity is 157. What we have in the current year is 34. The last 10 years average was 45, and the decline is 24%. Right? So this is a pretty significant story here. So, and this is what we should try and highlight, that this is a systematic neglection of the reservoir systems or whatever the monitoring systems are there. Whoever is responsible for it, they're not doing their job, and hence we are in the situation. So the disaster, the drought is, while the rain is one factor, it's also a man-made disaster. We made it worse by not taking the necessary measures. So that's how we have to infer this data and get this data out into the public domain. Because think about it, how many people are going to go in and look at this information and try to understand it this way? Not a lot of people would be willing to do that. So because we took the effort and we took the pain of going through this document and reading this information, if we don't present it in a way that's easily readable, then the whole cause is lost. And that's why, if you see here, what I'm doing here is I've taken all that data and prepared the simple graphs, because this gives me a clear picture just by looking at it. I don't even have to read what I've written in the blog. I can just look at this saying that, okay, total is this much has been disbursed, and you know, and this is what the government is saying in terms of how we can prevent it, and so on and so forth. So that's the analysis part. Why we need to do the analysis is to draw these conclusions. Yes.
Yes, Suresh. I don't know if the joint may be showing the right window, but all those figures about the water and other stuff are quite not there on the screen.
So which screen are you looking at right now?
We are looking at something like on the drought, just anti-drought plan for Bundelkhand, causes of drought, brochure on statutory corporations, companies, and other bodies.
Right now, I'm looking at the search results.
The search results.
And then it's changing back.
Oh, I see. I don't know why it will not show you.
Oh, that might be a different window that popped up, maybe.
So right now, what you see here is excessive use of water in sports events.
Yeah.
Problem faced by tea industry, that one?
Yep.
Oh, I see. So the storage capacity of reservoirs, you guys didn't see that?
That reduction in 24%, I think I was able to see that. I'm not sure about others.
Okay. So this document, you're able to see the one that I'm highlighting right now.
Yep.
Okay. So I was just referring to my blog. Now, I don't know why my blog doesn't show up here.
Yeah, I can see it.
You can see it?
Even I can see.
Oh, okay.
Perfect. I'm refreshing mine then. Hopefully, sure.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Sure. So that's the purpose of the analysis and how we do this. Why we need to look at the government data, because pretty much what the government does is whenever these kind of situations arise. So let's say in 2016 there was a drought. What it will immediately do is it will commission a team or a committee to look into the drought and say that, okay, can you come up with some recommendations as to how the drought can be managed or what preventive measures need to be taken? And this exercise is pretty much done. Every freaking 5 years, a new government comes, they'll completely disregard whatever work the previous governments have done. They'll do their own committee, they'll do their own analysis, and then the documents are published, but nothing comes out of it. Now, if I scroll through this, if I go all the way to the 39th page in my this thing, and there's also, sometimes I think I just trick it to say, yeah, actually it allows you to go to that page directly, but if you give the page number here. So I'll show you that the same conversations on the drought have been happening even in 2012, 2013, and 2014. The wordings may change a little bit. Maybe the ministry has changed, the minister has changed, but you will see that the gist of the conversation still remains the same. So this drought situation has not happened overnight. The same things have been spoken, the same things have been analyzed over and over again. Unfortunately, no action gets translated on the ground, and hence today there's a situation where people are facing this severe crisis, and the worst hit are the farmers.
Okay, and I have a question. You know, the storage of water in the reservoirs, you know, it is rain-fed, right? It is purely rain-fed. And how can a, government, they can, clean up the reservoirs so that there is no, sediments and all, and so that the water can be stored appropriately. But apart from that, what should they be doing in order to improve the storage capacity of the reservoir? Rather than just apart from rebuilding it or increasing its height. Apart from that, what are the other things they can do in order to
Right. So the drought management itself, and that's where the drought management aspects come into picture, right? Now, if you see here, this data was released by the Central Water Commission. So there is a separate department to just, do these kind of analysis, the monitoring, and so on and so forth. And these guys also have recommendations on how to deal with these problems. So it's not like they just keep track of these things. They record these things and also suggest what are the appropriate actions that need to be taken on the ground. And what these departments do is they also, go to the central government and say that, okay, these are the conditions and this is how much of money we need to sort of improve the storage capacities. You can build check dams there. You can build canals, water canals, and you can also think about the reasons why there is this dramatic reduction is obviously the rainfall has been declining, right? That's one simple reason. Mm-hmm. But if you dig deeper into this, what is happening to the environment around us? Whether the rate of construction has gone up, whether the rate of tree felling has also gone up, right? You also need to analyze these kind of things to see why the rainfall has gone down dramatically, why the temperatures are rising. So these are all the things that will come out of this kind of monitoring of the data.
Okay.
Right? Mm-hmm. So I wanted to just show you. Yeah, so I was telling you, right, the drought situation, so this was in 2014. If you see here, even in 2014, there were talks about impact of weak monsoon on agriculture. Right? This was August 2014. We see assistance for crop loss, suicide by farmers, hike in price of vegetables. So the same discussions, and I bet if you go into the UPA government, even they will be discussing about the same things, about the same drought, same management and everything. So it's a pretty much, there is this other integrated water, I think. So pretty much it's the same story, yeah.
Yeah, so I hear the story is going to be the same regardless of which government, as you're saying. But does this report also specify what should be the measures taken at the end?
Yeah.
And why would the new government come in? It's just so basically the situation won't be changing. So does the government even implement any of them? Is there any onus on them to implement it?
So this is what, if you're looking at this, are you able to see my blog here? I have a preparedness plans, right? Yeah. So this preparedness plan was prepared by NDRF, which again is a National Disaster Response, something. I forget what the F stands for. But here, they're talking about the preparedness plans and the preventive measures. And this document, I took it out from a 2012, a document that was published in 2012. Uh-huh. And similarly, similar documents were published even before that. Now, if you look at this closely, what they're saying is, how can you prepare for drought? They're saying, okay, improvement in agriculture to modifying cropping patterns, right? Because you know that, for example, if you take paddy, paddy is heavily water-intensive crop. Now, you know that a certain area, the water, paddy, the rain is very less. You can prepare in advance saying that, okay, instead of paddy, why not I grow millets? Because millets can even survive in dry conditions. So that's what they're saying. How can we prepare for drought? Use the cropping patterns. Then development of water resource system with improved irrigation. So to your point, yes, there is a lot of this information that's already available. But, you know, on the ground, it's not implemented. And I'll give you a real example here. So a few days ago, I read an article on Better India about this lady. Her name was Amla Rui, I think, or Amla Rai. She did about 200 check dams in Rajasthan over a course of, I think, 2-3 years or so. And all those villages today, even under these extreme drought conditions, they have sufficient water. Right? And this is, I'm talking Rajasthan. Mm-hmm. And so I happened to call her up for the past 3-4 days we have been talking. And I said, you know, I want to learn more about what you guys are doing and how you're doing this and so on and so forth. So she explained to me all the details. And I said, hey, listen, the government is also saying they'll be building all these check dams. Why can't you leverage the government funds? And why don't we use the government resources to do this? So one thing she said, which makes perfect sense, but if you do not work on the ground, you cannot actually, you know, learn why this is so complicated. So her point was, what the way the government works is the government says, okay, I'm going to allocate 100 crores money to build 100 check dams in these districts, right? That's what the government says. Now, the guys who are responsible for building these check dams, they will go in there, they'll take their necessary whatever bricks or cements or whatever they have to do, they go in, and irrespective of whether the check dams are being built in the proper location or the proper terrains, and you know, the check dams also, there's a little science to it, right? You cannot just go in and build a check dam anywhere. It has to be at an elevated place. It has to be in a place where you can, if the water is collected, when it spreads, it's also going to sort of go into the nearby canals and so on and so forth. But the way government operates is it's going to go in, build the check dams, and then have a sign saying that, okay, the check dams have been built, and then they go in and go out. And what happens is, if you don't make the villagers part of this whole exercise, if you don't make them the stakeholders, there's obviously no interest for them in maintaining those check dams properly, and it just is a, you know, complete waste of resources. And what these guys have been doing is, Amala and her team have been doing, they first go into these villages, they make the villagers part of their team, and then they say, okay, help us understand the village locations, the terrains, you know, how, when water falls, where does it flow from? Where is the higher altitudes? So you are making the villagers part of this whole exercise, and then you build the check dam, and then they will be given the responsibility. And what these guys also say is the villagers also should be able to bear some expense of building these check dams. Only then they will be responsible, and they'll help maintain these check dams properly. So this is where there is a big gap in what the government says and what actually gets implemented on the ground.
So quick question, what Amala is doing is the funds finally for the check dam are coming from the government, or she's raising it?
No, she raises part of it. Part of it, she's saying that she will get it from the villagers, because she only goes and builds it if the villagers are committing their resources or money to help build those things.
Oh, wow, that's really brave. So I'm a similar situation with the Mission Kakatiya, right? They've completed about 8,000 to 10,000 the repairs to the tanks, but there's no committees in the village to take care of them. So 2-3 years off, I mean, everything is going to go in ruins again because someone is going to just go break the burn. So that thing is, as you're saying, is very true. That should be there. Another thing is Telangana was asking for something close to 1,200 crores, and then they were given 56 crores. There's a gap. Who asked for this 2,000 crores or whatever? Telangana puts it across? Or
the this one was so the state has the NDRF, which is one of the disaster departments for assistance, and they asked for some, I think, 1,000 crores, but they only got whatever. I don't know if I still have the document here, but they got
very less amount, right? Had they been given all those 2,000 crores, then we wouldn't be having drought. Is that's why they calculated as 2,000?
No. It's not. It doesn't translate it to that. Like I said, so the way the expenditure department also does their analysis is also the state can claim whatever funds they want from the center. Right. Yeah. But then there is another department which actually says, OK, we have evaluated your situation and based on all the situation and the current available resources and the funds, this is how much of money we can allocate. And that's how they come up with this number. Sometimes this number is too low. Sometimes the number is too high. And, you know, it all is the way they assess the situation.
And getting funds look like. So that's definitely.
Yeah. Friends, hi, Shikhar. There are some things that I'd like to add. This Kishan here. That's part of that's part of the reason when I started some analysis regarding this. What I felt was with the government, any dependence on the government is a huge bottleneck, be it the resources, be it policy making, I don't know how to explain it. So for drought areas, so there are two things, right? One is normal fertile areas which are drought affected during some years, and then there are the drought affected areas which are having problems which for let's say if there's a successful crop 1 year, then for 8 years there's a failure crop, there is a crop failure. So if you want to be successful in those areas, it's a completely holistic management. One of the things that Shikhar spoke last time when we met was about the using the organic crops, so which are traditionally drought resistant, and along with that, good financial management practices. Someone who is working continually with the farmers, and one of the things, I don't know if you noticed in the past discussion that we had over the last half an hour, is the lack of information that is with. So we discussed about Mission Kakatiya, right? So one of the things, even though Telangana government prestigiously took it up, as long as the farmers are not, what do you say in Telugu? We say, Raitulu Bhagaswamila Okunda, Raitulegal, citizens. Unless the citizens become partakers in all these development activities, these projects, you know, it's really difficult to be successful. One of the things is you build a check dam, and then what about the canal that you build from the check dam? And even if you build a canal, how do you know the farmers are going to use? So, to be fair to the government, what I feel is they have very limited resources. And even if they need 1,000 crores, and some year they can allocate only 100 crores, and some year a few lakhs. So the government priorities change. And So that's one thing. And the third thing is the drought affected areas, the weather plays a very critical role. You need to be on tabs about the exact percentage of moisture at which you plant the seed. You expect the plant to grow, and then you do the you actually do the harvest. So again, for the monsoon data and the weather data, we are completely dependent on government, which does not have weather management systems except in the district headquarters. So that's a huge problem in my view, because a district, let's say Chennai district. So Chennai will have at the airport and maybe in Guindy. But what about Adyar? You know, a farmer in Adyar will have a different weather pattern compared to what's at the airport. So these are some of the challenges we have before us.
Yeah, I mean, that's very true. That there's a big gap in the implementation and lack of accountability. And most important part, as you know, what Kishan said, and also I mentioned earlier, was if the people who you're trying to supposedly help, if you don't make them the stakeholders, then no matter how much you do, whatever you do, it really doesn't make a difference. The same thing happened with the simple building the toilets, this thing, right? The UPA government started this, and then followed by the BJP government now. What is happening is they go in and they say, okay, we'll give you 5,000 rupees if you build the toilet. They'll build the toilet. But then we have found, when I filed an RTI, we have found that those toilets in some cases were used as additional storage spaces, and people were just using the open defecation for all their this thing. So the point is, it's not simply building a toilet, it's also building behavior. And if you don't do that, then no matter what programs you do, however good they are, it just goes down the drain. So at this point, I'll just stop and see if folks have any questions or any comments.
So quick question is, two questions. One is, what is the purpose you think would be the end purpose of finding all this stuff in Lok Sabha pages or anywhere else about what, who said what about drought and what the conditions? Or is it some government department already crunching these numbers and coming up with something? What are we trying to do here? Are we trying to go ask the governments about so many things are there and you're not looking into it, or find reasons why they are not? So that's one.
Shrikar, is it okay if I say a few things and then you can conclude? Is it okay?
Sure. Go ahead.
Yeah. So the thing is, the government has a very mature practice. If you go to Sri Krishna Deva Raya University website in Anantapuram district in Andhra Pradesh, they have an extremely mature practice for drought, extremely mature research for drought-related farming. And the government, to be fair, has very mature resources. End goal of this, we are all trying to help the farmers. So how we achieve it is a modality that we should all work on.
Okay, I think in a generic broad answer, I think we're all trying to help farmers, but whom are we trying to bring pressure on? Are we going to bring pressure on the government or the farmer himself, saying that not following the best practices is what is leading to their problems as well as compounding government's problems? I mean, where are we starting?
So let me add to what Kishan just said. What is happening now is, you know, we published these calls, the details of these calls, about a month or two ago, and we are now here about 10 or 12 people on the call and trying to understand what all the drought is about, or what does it mean for analyzing the data and so on and so forth. Now, the fact that all of us came together is that it just shows that how serious we are about doing something about it. Now, it's in this process that first thing is we need to equip ourselves with all the data that we can gather so that we understand how exactly the drought manifests itself. That's mm-hmm. that's one thing. The first purpose is educating ourselves. The second thing is, if we all know by now that the drought is not a situation that has happened overnight. So the obvious question is, what has been happening for all these years? Why is the government not doing anything? So the analysis that we are attempting to do will bring out those facts. And then at that point, we should try and get this information out to as many people as possible, use social media, use print media, use whatever. And there are a lot of these websites today, like you can see factly.in or you can see India Spend or other websites who are more than happy to take all this analysis and actually publish in those. So what happens is once you try to spread this awareness, if tomorrow you come up and say, okay, now I'm going to take up water management in these mandals or in these villages, right? You are building credibility and you are saying, I know exactly what I'm doing, why I'm doing. Because if I do this now, for the next 10, 15 years, there's no situation, there's no drought. Even if it happens, we can manage it. And the fourth point is, if you know the policies, now when you get down to the actual village level and the mandal level and start working on this, we can approach the district collectors there and question them saying, hey, as per these government documents, this is the policy that's available. This is the crop assistance that the farmer should get. And these are all the other government provisions that the farmer can avail in the situation of a drought. And you'll be surprised to know that the collectors, the district collectors, the subdivisional magistrates and all these people, by and large, are very cooperative. They are like more than willing to help out.
Oh, yeah.
If somebody approaches and takes the onus of executing things, what the collectors do not have is the people who can execute things on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And if we can go and play that role, and then the collectors and the district administration, they are willing to help us out in other areas. They can provide the financial assistance or any other government resources.
Schemes. Okay, gotcha. So that's one part of the thing. And other second question was capacity building is what you're probably referring to, where building the capacity of the villagers or like the citizens in the village so that they ask questions, know about things, and they understand themselves why planting paddy is not a good idea because mm-hmm. they're depending on rain and whatnot, and it could be droughts continuously.
Right.
How to diversify and like, you know, have a little bit of animal husbandry going on and
right.
a few sheep and flock and whatnot. So that kind of capacity building, obviously, government is not doing anywhere. There's a bunch of channels that no one watches or watches but don't learn. So is there any way, because ultimately, as you're saying, behavior change is what we need. And probably enlightened citizens would probably be the first part where they would not be taken for a ride by anybody and demand the right things from a local MLA or representative instead of a couple of thousands and vote for him. So,
right.
is there a plan to enlighten those guys? And obviously, government is not doing much. So, are there something else that we?
So again, there are NGOs on the ground who are actually working. I mean, I for Farmers is working with Raita Swaraj Vedika and CSA as well. We have two mandals where the work is already underway. And hopefully we will, so when I say the work is underway, the way it works is the volunteers, they go into these villages and spend time with the villagers. They establish the contacts, they establish the trust, and then they'll identify these local leaders in these villages. And through them, they try to dissipate the information. And then they will understand what are the challenges that villages and the mandals are facing. And depending on that, they'll come up with a plan. So in this context, in the drought context especially, the plan is to build these water management tools, if you will. So the check dams is one thing, right? But the check dams also requires a particular kind of terrain. Like, I don't know if are you able to see this Better India page?
Let's see.
Is anyone able to see this?
Yep.
Okay. So So this is what I was telling about, and she is Amla Ruiya, who built the almost 100 villages in Rajasthan using the check dam. So the thing is, these check dams also need to happen. So these are all the check dams, and these happen to be built in a sort of a strategic way. And if you can see here, this portion, this is slightly on the there's a slope right after that. So not everywhere you will get these kind of terrains, and not everywhere it's possible to build these check dams. So there, in some cases, you need to build these sort of water ponds near the small ponds near the farm fields themselves. So other kinds of water management things you need to come up with. So the team is assessing all this information on the ground. And then it's also the discussion will be geared towards, okay, what are the kinds of crops that you're growing? What we need to do in case of the current drought situation. There are some drought-resistant seeds as well, which are not, if you look at Lok Sabha page, you will see some reference to drought-resistant seeds, but they're talking about biogenetically, developed.
Modified.
But there are some indigenous seeds too, which are drought-resistant. Which the farmers in some areas have been using. So this is all the information that these volunteers will be sharing and spreading. Likewise, I was in India just a week ago, a very brief trip, and I went to one of these villages in Kadapa. And over there, the same thing. We have a local leader who goes and talks to the villagers in the language that they understand. And he clearly says, I can only help if you're willing to help yourselves. I don't want to give you the food. I'll show you how to earn that food. And if you want, then you can come along and, join me in that effort. So this is how the local leaders themselves try to give that information. And only through that local partnership is any of these efforts ever work.
Yeah, thank you.
Sure.
And there are a number of things, like I was talking to Rayalaseema Social Forum last week, and one of the things the way he worked for the suicides, for example, is they're having, every village has a temple, right? And all the elders, the retired people, they meet at the temple. And then these villagers, if they're facing some kind of a crisis, really they are not dying because of the lack of money, rather a sense of despondency, and they go and meet, and they said that has helped the people quite a bit, and there are myriad ways we can contribute, I feel.
Right, and as part of that, the discussion that we were having, right, with Amla, so this is a proposal that they said. I basically wanted to execute one of their check dam proposals in one of the villages. So this is the village that they chose for us. In Rajasthan, so the budget estimate was about 6 lakhs, because what the check dam that they're building is about almost 10 feet wide and 10 feet long, and it's pretty elaborate one. So I'm still looking at all the other information that they have given, but in terms of what we are doing for the drought management, this is just one exercise. The reason why we are doing is to learn how these things work. And the second point that I wanted to highlight is that, so now that we know a little bit about drought and what the government policies are, at least we know how to access all that information to a certain extent. And I'll talk more specifically about Telangana, for example. I've already said in the beginning of our call that this monsoon season is going to be a very good monsoon. So if we wait for another 3 months, the entire focus from drought will be shifted away, or probably it's going to die down. So what we need to do in these 3 months is try and reach out to the district collectors in Telangana, or if somebody has access to even the MLAs or anybody, basically, or even in the press, right? What we need to make sure is we have to capitalize on these 3 months and sort of come up with some concrete plan. We're also working along the same lines with our ground teams to come up with something very comprehensive. Instead of focusing on just one mandal, two mandal, we need to be more aggressive and say, okay, we want to target 100 mandals to have water management structures built in the next 3 months or in the next 6 months. If we don't come up with those kind of targets, then I'm afraid that with the monsoons coming, everything will be like completely washed away. So the second goal of this call is also to equip ourselves with the data and also reach out to the district collectors, MLAs, to the press and whoever that is, and stress on the need for building these sort of water management structures in the next few months. And whatever budget it needs, whatever things we need to do for that to happen, we need to do. It's almost like a campaign that we have to start. You know, have the government pressurize and do something about building these things now. And the same thing goes for Maharashtra and other drought-affected regions as well. So hopefully in the next week, I don't know how many of you guys know about Kiran Vissa, but he will be coming to the U.S. For another conference that we have. So once he comes, hopefully we'll be able to finalize those details. And then, that's a much larger campaign to be taken up. And just yesterday, I think, or today, there was also some other good news with the Supreme Court weighing in on the drought conditions and asking the center why they did not take any measures to curtail the drought or manage the drought situation. And I think the part two of the judgment is going to come either today or tomorrow. And Swaraj Abhiyan actually filed this PIL in Supreme Court, and the judgment just came today. So there's good pressure also on the government, but I think the pressure has always been there, in my view, and this data itself is a testimony to that. What is missing is the execution part, and that's where, if possible, if we can use our contacts, even it could be in our villagers. So let's say you guys are from different parts of India, and you have access to villages, and if you can talk to your people in the villages and ask them if they have any water management structures. If they do not, are they willing to work towards it? If they are, then we can help facilitate those things.
So a question in particular with Telangana. So basically with the Mission Kakatiya going on for the second time, second phase now, looks like a lot of villages are being covered towards tank restoration. So with that, do you think some parts of the drought are mitigated?
The thing is, the fact that we already are in a drought tells that the water table has completely depleted. Right? So even whatever measures you're taking now, for us to see the results of that is going to take a few years. It's good thing that the Telangana government is doing something proactively. But like I said, if the villagers are not part of it, then the chances of these initiatives really being successful is like very, very minimal. So what needs to happen is, if we can get our hands on, where exactly, what are the actual places where the Kakatiya mission has executed its plans, if we can get those details, and because you're already saying this is the second round, so hopefully the first round has already been done, we can revisit them, see what the conditions are. Based on that, we can assess, what is the success rate for this mission that it's going to be.
Yeah, that's a good approach. And I think, as you're telling, even if you talk to our village sarpanch or someone and say, hey, where the water can be stored or things like that, apart from what Mission Kakatiya is doing, I think that would be a good point for everybody to rally around and make it happen in the village.
Go ahead.
To some degree, I think, again, I come back to the same thing where from a villager's perspective, at least the couple of times that I visited in the last 3-4 years, my own village, the people's expectation is not so much to get involved and make things change, but it sounded as if they were waiting on some dole to be given out and, you know, sops to be given out by the government more. So,
you know, that's at a very, very high level, that's probably true, because in a way the whole system has been built such that the farmers always remain a big vote bank, and they are made completely dependent on the government subsidies and all those things. But the reality is, if you go spend time with the villagers, sit down with them, talk to them, you know, they are more than willing to, listen to you, and more than willing to do things that, you know, that will help them develop more. Now, here's a picture I wanted to show. This is the village that I had visited, and he's our partner in Kadapa. Vijay Kumar is like the, you know, he's like the walking encyclopedia for plants. You show him a plant, he'll tell you what exactly is wrong with the plant. That's how good he is. And these are two farmers who saw his newspaper advertisement and came from almost 60 kilometers in like hot sun, and they wanted to switch to organic farming. And they wanted to ask Vijay Kumar how to do it, what are the things that these guys need to do, and so on and so forth, because they have been facing such a hard time with, no matter how much chemicals they are spraying, they are not able to get the required level of, the yield that they expect for them to break even. So to your point, it's definitely, there needs to be an effort made to reach out to the villagers, and, you know, you can see the transformation happening there.
I see what you're saying. So basically, it is just a gap that not enough good willing people are reaching out to all the villagers for them to have a voice and make some change in their life with some guidance. I see.
Exactly. And so this is one village I visited where the village has only 80 families in there, and this is a most backward village. It's actually a SC village, scheduled caste village. Sorry, somebody is. Can someone mute? I think someone is talking over the phone.
Okay.
I guess. So, what I was telling is, so all these farmers, I mean, Vijay Kumar and his team have been visiting this village for about 2 months now. Finally, they agreed to sort of switch to organic farming. Because these guys were facing issues. They were not able to, control their costs. They were increasingly spraying more and more chemicals. And they were also looking for a way out, but they were not, they were not convinced that organic is the way to go, or whether they would have enough support to make that switch. Now, finally, they all agreed. And this is all the women farmers. The men, the land is on the women in this village, and they were collectively taking these decisions.
Wonderful.
So
awesome.
It is these kind of interventions that that need to happen, and if they happen, then nothing like it. And this is basically one example of a 1 acre land of a woman who belongs to that same village. And this was done as a pilot exercise. So what Vijay Kumar did was he gave the seeds. This is a kind of a millet. It's some gold millet. I forget the name. This crop grows in about 60 to 75 days.
Wow.
This entire field that you see was grown in 60 to 75 days. This was about 1 acre land. And she got about, I think, 4 quintals. Not 4 quintals, maybe five to 7 quintals of this. And each quintal is about 3,000 rupees, 2,500 rupees in the market. So I took these pictures and showed this to them. And Vijay Kumar also spoke about these things. And, they were all very excited to, switch to organic farming. And I'll just show one other thing here. Does everybody understand Telugu?
Yeah, I can.
Okay.
Yeah, I can.
So I'm going to just play this song. I don't know if you guys can hear it, but it's on my Facebook profile, actually. I'll try to put some volume. Basically, this is how he was trying to... This was like an ice-breaking session.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. I just did read it. And you guys were talking about some serials and all.
Right.
You
know?
బుద్ధిరాదుర వాణ్ణి దద్దమ్మలు చేయకుండ దారి చూపరా మనం మారితే ఈ బ్రతుకు మారురా జనం మారితే ఈ జగతి మారురా మనం మారితే ఈ బ్రతుకు మారురా.
I mean, you can listen to the whole song on this this link here. But the point I'm trying to make to your question is, if the right level of intervention is done, taking the villagers into confidence, making them the stakeholders, then definitely things can change. And these are changes that will sustain. It won't, you know, roll back if Vijay Kumar leaves or we do not, you know, go into those villages to check and see how things are going. These are like sustainable changes because the villagers themselves are part of this.
I see what you're saying. And looks like someone from outside has to come in and then talk and volunteer like that. So I was wondering for my village in Nalgonda, at least, I was wondering if a volunteer I could somehow approach.
So what I would suggest is, actually recently somebody did approach me from Guntur. They said their parents and other relatives of her were also into organic farming, into chemical-based farming. And for many years, they were not able to sort of, have enough income. So I suggested, mm-hmm. why don't you go with organic farming and put a condition in there. I'm going to have Vijay Kumar visit your place. But mm-hmm. you should make an effort to gather at least 20 farmers. And then mm-hmm. Vijay Kumar will come and talk to them, and he will make other visits, subsequent visits as well, to share the crops that the seeds that he has been harvesting himself, and also the mm-hmm. organic manure he produces. It's called the Sanjeevani Rasayanam.
Right.
So he's more than willing to travel. And likewise, we have contacts in Hyderabad as well who can make those trips. But I would strongly suggest you make an effort to pool the farmers, at least you do the groundwork. And then when these guys come, at least there's some level of expectations that are already set.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. I agree with you. And how long will Vijay Kumar be able to engage them? Like in like a week or so? Or?
I mean, so the thing is, this will happen in like multiple sessions, right? And obviously Vijay Kumar lives in Kadapa. Travel for him is also going to be, expensive. So he can come in the first session. He will sort of prepare everybody, give all the information. And if somebody can go back with Vijay Kumar, he will even share the seeds and also the techniques on how to prepare the Sanjeevani Rasayanam. So once if we can do it that way, then mm-hmm. you can basically utilize the best of both and And we're also trying to have a video recording of the Sanjeevani Rasayanam and those things.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Follow
that.
Mm-hmm. So that we can share the CDs for people who are interested.
Gotcha. Sure. So more or less, we're looking for a couple of volunteers from the village to become experts with him. At the same time, 20-30 farmers who would be taking the lead into becoming organic farmers.
At least, it's a sizable number of farmers, 15 to 20, so that, when Vijay Kumar visits those places, it's worth his, time on the trip.
Okay. Thank you.
And I had a question, how do you pool in the resources? For example, I forgot the name of the person who was helping the villagers to build dams and all of that, right?
Canada.
So, yeah, and how do they pull in the resources? Like, you know, if they're not depending upon the government, or they're not working, with the government and using the funds used by the government, then how are they pulling the resources? Like, they would need I presume they would need a civil engineer or architect to design and do all of that. So how does that work?
I mean, so let me take the last question first. So they don't need necessarily an architect or an engineer, civil engineer, to build these things, because these are some structures that the farmers themselves can build once you tell them. So this is like another check dam. If you're able to see my screen here, there's a simple check dam based on the terrain that they have. And for that, all they need is like, okay, where do we need to build and how long and how wide and so on and so forth. It doesn't need much of expertise in there. And the organization, the Akar Trust, has built over 100 check dams so far. So they have the necessary knowledge to inspect these places and build these check dams and so on and so forth. Now, if I'm looking at their website, right, because I saw their donors here, in terms of how they sustain their activities, they have all these foundations and different people coming together to help them with. So, for example, these guys gave about $30,000, and that covered about they built six check dams. With that, so the reason why they are hugely successful in Rajasthan, again, this is what Amala told me when I called her yesterday. So she said that they speak the same language as the villagers. So language is a very, very important barrier to overcome. Because they speak Hindi, they speak some Rajasthani, it was easy for them to interact with the villagers in Rajasthan and sort of, go into the villages, talk to them more, and understand them and execute these projects. I asked her why she can do the same thing in Telangana and Maharashtra and other places. She said, I don't have the language and I don't have the necessary connections in those places to be able to do this.
Correct. Okay.
Shrikar, I'd like to add something.
Puja, your teacher gave two books from school, the
Hello?
Motivation
so,
body. Where are those two books?
Shrikar, I'd like to add some few things.
But she already sent two books. That's what she told. What
I think
books?
I think you meant Suresh, right?
She already sent two books.
Yeah, I think is it Malik or Kishan?
This is Kishan here.
Hi, Kishan. I think you meant Suresh. Suresh is the one who is speaking. Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Suresh, I'd like to add a few things.
Sure.
What I feel is the scale before is not... if you are talking about India, the scale before us is not a small scale. It's a huge... I mean, we all need to work where we can. And we need to raise awareness. We need to raise people. And it's not a small task. Like, for example, the Mission Kakatiya that is happening. So if you take any government policy, the real success is debated in decades. If you see why the acuteness of the farming crisis right now is because 3 decades of failure, minimum. And so the scale before us, the time before us, although the crisis that is unfolding is catastrophic, we can work like what Suresh pointed out, right? If you miss these 3 months, then until next year, unless next year the rains fail, there's no way we can get people support. That's what we are up against. And the second thing is one of the things I wanted to say is the Krishna Basin. Krishna Basin is a deficit basin. It's one basin in the entire country where there is no sufficient water. And how many ever projects you build there and how much ever water you divert, there is no water. And second thing is, let's say you do interlinking and bring the water. I was just reading about the water projects in Rayalaseema region, and I found that the Krishna Basin is based on basalt rock. And for the basalt rock, the salts need to go into the sea. Now, with irrigation, what's happening is all these salts are going into various parts of the Rayalaseema region and other Tungabhadra Basin and all these basins, right? Right, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, and Telangana. So when we build these projects, right now the alkalinity of the water for the, that we are using for irrigation is 450 mg per cubic meter or something like that. And when it crosses 500 mg, pretty much, I don't remember the exact numbers, but when it crosses 500 mg, the waters cannot support irrigation. So that's a catastrophe that is in waiting. And when that happens, again, it's back to square one. So, and that's what is before. And the work that we have to put is sacrificial. And the sacrifice is not for a month or a 2 month. It will be for decades. And that's what we are up against. That's my view.
Yeah, very, very true.
Yeah, just to add to that, actually, there are, there's salt in the Krishna water that you're saying, but there's parts of Nalgunda district that are completely with fluoride. So there's already issues that we're seeing everywhere. And a lot of people that complain also is they try to do the reverse osmosis just to drink, but ultimately all the plants, they're taking in this fluoride and salts and whatnot. So at some point, we should also address that part. Not only the crops become organic, but even the water becomes pure that we feed it, because there's no point. Because recently there was this issue with the Nestle and whatnot, the Maggi stuff going on. And obviously no company wants to bring the expensive lead and put it in the flour that makes the noodles, right? So obviously, but the water that these guys were using to prepare those wheat or whatever plants is all laden with lead, and then it went into the crop itself, and then they had to recall like crores of rupees of stuff. So I think that's also at some point we have to make sure that the farmers get the right water, not free from all these salts and fluorides and leads.
Yeah, I mean, these are definitely, you know, a lot of very serious issues which have been neglected for, I don't know how many ever years. And the effect of that is what we are seeing today. But I think in terms of what our next step should be, like I said earlier, I'll just reiterate to sort of make sure everybody's on the same page, is that we can take up one aspect of the drought, right? Like I said, the drought is, you know, there are various perspectives of the drought. So, for example, I'm not sure if everybody's familiar with this NREGS, which is the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, which says that, okay, we'll provide you 100 days of employment, which is guaranteed per family.
Earlier it was Rajiv Gandhi,
Rose
Gandhi.
Rajiv Gandhi,
They keep changing the names. That's all the governments always do. But if you look at the NREGS, you will see that in the drought-prone areas, they have, instead of, I think, 100 days, they have now said they'll give 150 days of guaranteed work. Now, so this is one aspect that we can analyze further. Okay, what are those areas where the 150 days has been implemented? And how effective, here they have mentioned, like 231 mandals in Telangana, Andhra Pradesh 359, and so on and so forth. Now, we can further dig into this information, saying that, what are these different mandals? You know, what we can file an RTI, get that information out. We can reach out to the district collectors, and so on and so forth. So this is one aspect. The other aspect is the reservoirs that we already saw, right? What are these reservoirs? What is the Central Water Commission saying about these reservoirs in terms of how to rejuvenate them? The other thing could be this flood drought resistances. I mean, I'm just picking things randomly, but there are so many aspects of the drought that is hidden in these government data that is worth looking at, and not just from a purely learning exercise, but also something that we can effectively use on the ground. So I would strongly encourage if people can devote time and take one aspect of it, and you guys can sort of, we can easily coordinate among ourselves so there is no duplication of effort. We can pick and choose whatever topics we want to. And the second thing would be, like I said, you know, try and identify your villages to see if those villages that either you know or you come from have any of these drought management systems in place, the water management systems in place. And if not, whether they are willing to work towards building them so that the future drought situation can be managed well. And if they are willing to, then we can work on how to facilitate that in terms of the financial or in terms of any knowledge that they need to build these necessary water management things. So these at a very high level are some of the takeaways from this call that probably I want to just reiterate.
Yep, sounds good.
Suresh, this Kishan here. If there is something, I mean, I would like to certainly contribute. So if you can, I mean, if there is something that's on your mind specifically, please let me know, and I would like to contribute.
Sure.
In whatever way I can.
I mean, like I already said, this one project in Rajasthan, I'm very, you know, eager to execute that project. So right now I'm still trying to get more details about that location in Rajasthan.
Okay.
And once it's finalized, I'll definitely communicate to you. But that's like a cost of about 6 lakhs or something. I said I can I can pool up to 5 lakhs, and she said that's fine too. She can get the remaining 1.5 lakhs. So this is definitely a project that we will be doing.
So, okay, that is something you're planning in Rajasthan, is it?
Yes, this is a sure shot project that we'll be executing in Rajasthan.
Sure.
And the rest of the places, Telangana and AP, it's going to take some time before things materialize and we know exactly to what extent we will be taking up activities in those places.
For sure. Yeah, definitely. Maybe I'll just get familiarized myself in those areas. And I think one of the things that you're pointing out is that we need to gather some funds as well, right? Towards
yes.
that project. Okay. Yeah. I'll definitely focus on that, and whatever I can do from here in Calgary, definitely I will do it, and I'll be in touch with you.
Sure.
And Suresh, whatever project, you know, you can just, you know, you know, just drop a note to everyone, and then whomever is interested can pitch in.
Yeah, absolutely. We will certainly do that. And another thing that we wanted to also try and see is we also are open to, when I say we as in IFR Farmers, the team, me, Shrikar, and Srini, and a few other people, we are willing to also, you know, travel if need be, where we can have these sessions in smaller groups if you guys think that that will be effective. Because what we want to, again, like I said, we definitely don't want to miss this opportunity. I see this crisis as an opportunity. The drought as a crisis is actually an opportunity for us to do something about it. And if we can reach out to, you know, individuals who probably want to do something but do not have the access, and they have apprehensions and things like that, do let us know. If it's an East Coast, then we can travel by road. If it's West Coast, then we need to think about that a bit. But to the extent, we'll definitely try and see if some of those trips can also be done.
Sure, Suresh. Suresh, I just remembered something. I thought I'll share it with you. I was discussing, about the farming crisis in India with one Canadian person, and he has told me that Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is doing a lot of work for sustainable thing, and I checked the website. Yes, they are doing an amazing thing. And what he said is these things will mostly be done with a business plan. So I just wanted to say, I had put that on back burner because I'm just new to this and I don't know how to manage all this, but definitely I'll get on board with that as well. And if we can get Bill in, since Lakshmi Rai has done amazing work in Rajasthan, we can use that as a use case to promote it. And perhaps, if we get Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation support for the entire country, that certainly sounds like a possibility, but of course we have to have we have to be able to convince them. But God willing, if we can achieve that, that'll be great.
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing like it, right? The other side of that aspect is, so one thing is to get the funds, right? That's not easy task, but nevertheless, if we reach out and try and create more awareness, maybe that's possible. The other aspect of that is also making sure that there are teams on the ground who are willing to be part of this whole exercise. We need both to happen at the same time for these kind of things to have a lasting impact.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yep, sounds good. My only quick point is for Rajasthan, the check dams, there sure should be some amount of funds that you could get from government without the overhead of, randomly they come up and do something and go away. Don't you think it might be better to...
the government is... Share? So these guys have so far built about 200 check dams, right?
Right, I hear that.
And they have done this primarily based on whatever money they were able to raise and from the locals and so on and so forth. The way the governments work is sometimes you need to know people in the government to be able to even get access to those funds. So it's one thing that the government is saying, okay, we have these budget allocated for that. But when it comes to actually utilizing it for the purpose that it's supposed to be, it's really challenging to get those funds. So I really didn't want to push her along those lines, although I did ask her about it. It's beyond our control.
Yeah, probably Rajasthan is a different state altogether, looks like, with the things going on there. But I was wondering, even if it's like to build a check dam, shouldn't the river, stream or whatever is still a government property, right? You need to have some access and permissions to build anything on it. And the maintenance should be through the government agencies ultimately, right?
No, not really. I mean, I don't think the whole thing is the in the villages, in an ideal world, there's panchayats, mm-hmm. there are gram sabhas. These are the bodies that have been entitled to sort of oversee the development activities in the villages as per our constitution. However, that those bodies have been merely reduced to like some vote banks and mm-hmm. power politics and so on and so forth. Not all the states, but in by and large, that's the condition of these things. But there is no way they have mentioned that this is the responsibility of the government to maintain it, or they would be the whole and sole ownership. Because if they start doing that, then there's no end to it, because they are also limited by whatever resources they have. Like I said, if you guys think that we have better access to these funds in Telangana, we know people in Telangana who can make this happen, then by all means, let's start making those calls. Let's start getting those conversations going. We have the necessary knowledge. to make these water management structures built. And like I said, it's not simply a check dam that needs to be built. It can be, in some cases, simple ponds, simple water harvesting pits.
Watershed area.
Exactly. So we definitely have the knowledge and the wherewithal to do this. It's a question of you know, funds, and it's also a question of whether we are able to get the people to be part of those activities.
So another suggestion is my dad, after he retired as an engineer, civil engineer, he was part of something called a Japanese Development Bank. They give money to medium and minor irrigation projects and repairs. So I'm thinking if we approach them, probably they might be having some funds for these check dams in Rajasthan or even other places we think of.
Yeah, I mean, sure. So this is basically, I can share this website link and you can see all their activities. And if you can talk to those people and, you know, help them understand the activities that these guys are doing, and if they can help, nothing like it.
Awesome.
Because I think these guys have very good access to the villages in Rajasthan.
Mm-hmm.
Because they have been working in Rajasthan for many years now. And so if you were to take this up in the entire state of Rajasthan, I'm sure these guys will be very excited too. So
that'll be perfect. Then they can build another 1,500 pretty easily.
Yeah.
And the other thing, guys, is I think government recognizes that it doesn't have all the answers, nor it has the resources. And that's part of the reason why in many situations the governments are, various governments are allowing their citizens to take initiatives and complete these projects. Yeah, I mean, there will be cases where there will be sabotage, but I think overall there's a recognition for citizen-driven things in at least in some areas.
Yeah, that's true. That is very true.
And Suresh, I was wondering, for the topic for next time, do you think we could include something like engaging the rural people, like remotely, even through phone or something, to start off a conversation on, say, organic farming or field trenching or anything else, water management, conservation, things like that? What your experiences has been, or any case studies, or how people turn around, dynamics in the village kind of thing. That's something we can all vote on if we want to go about that.
I mean, getting the interaction with the villagers on the ground, that might be a bit tough, given that until the last minute, we are not sure whether the people on the ground will be available because there's so many things happening. I mean, if you're talking about Vijay Kumar,
not Vijay Kumar in particular, but if I want to talk to my own village people, like I know a few, but I don't know and how they react. You would have been in the same situation, right? You would have approached a bunch of people, and then, you know, how you've changed their perception.
Yeah, I mean, we could try it, but like I said, these kind of conversations. You saw how Vijay Kumar was, singing a song, he was talking to them in their own language and relating to the things, exactly, relating to the things that they see on a day-to-day basis. And these are all the things, all the small things, but are very important to make that connection. So phone conversation can really be like a very platonic experience, right? It has, may have no impact whatsoever. So I would at least let you talk to the people, maybe you know somebody on the ground, have them talk to them. And if they think that a conversation like this will help, then by all means, we can also do that. There's nothing wrong in trying that. But I would say that let that not be the first call.
Okay. I was thinking not a call with the village people as an entire team, but I was wondering if you could share your experiences when you went back to India and then.
Oh, okay. It's interesting, right? So the way I've always approached these villages is not like I'm not from a farming background. I don't have any connection with any of the farmers directly or any villages myself.
Suresh, let me interrupt you for a second. Is it Malik who is speaking to you?
Oh, this is Binoy, actually.
Yeah, Binoy. Binoy, I think we perhaps all of us, whatever, one of the first thing is building contacts at the local level. And you, as you said, it's your village. So once you can find a reliable person and are able to, like for example, for me, I'm in the same situation like Suresh. I don't have any contacts, and I've mostly studied in Chennai and other parts. So, but luckily, I have established some contact, for example, with the Rayalaseema Social Forum and something like that. But you, it's your own village, so you will know someone who will be able to, start some kind of this one. So once you build a relationship and are able to gather everyone, I think Suresh and Speaker are more than willing, and all of us are there to support each other. And whatever you need, definitely we can share the experience. I think Suresh, I think that kind of answer, that kind of sums it up, you think? Or
so my background is basically I used to go for summer holidays to the village, and not much. And then I know a couple of people, not entire village. I have a list of phone numbers of all the people in the village now, but the conversation is a little like new, because you know obviously I live in America, and they only see me once in a while, if at all. So what I was hoping for is if you guys, any of you, have particularly gone into a village and then interacted with people and then changed the perception, I was more or less hoping if what could be your what was your experience, not necessarily.
So I'll speak like when I went to Vidarbha and then I went to Kadapa into all those villages, right? So one thing I was surprised myself was the farmers actually approached me and asked me what they should be doing differently in order for them to sort of get more revenue.
Awesome.
I was really shocked because people did introduce me saying, okay, he's NRI, he lived there, but he has been helping some of our projects and so on and so forth, right?
Mm-hmm.
So my simple answer is, I said, you and your families or your parents and your grandparents, you've been doing farming for like many, many years now, probably a few generations. And you guys were never this dependent on everything. You are very independent. You used to harvest your own seeds. You used to have a cow. You used to have a goat. You used to have your own field. You used to do everything within your field. You never went to the market to buy chemicals or fertilizers.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just say these things again and again, saying, you have to go back to what your parents and grandparents were doing, become more independent, and then do things the way your parents and grandparents were doing. So I will say, I'm nobody to tell you what you need to do. You just have to go back to what your family has been doing all along. And that those kind of things are actually what I found was very well received. And I didn't prepare any of this. This is something that came out instinctively, and I firmly believe in that, because they know what they're doing. It's just that the conditions under which they operate make them so dependent on everything.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
And
Suresh, one point is now that Binoy has said it, we should think of a strategy, because as the requirement increases and as we are serving more, definitely there will be a more ask, and we need to be prepared we need to be prepared with a strategy. So I think we may not be able to have a ground team or something, but definitely some structure we need to develop so that we'll be able to support every person who is who wants to contribute.
Yeah. I think we already have the ground teams, like in terms of us interacting with the people on the ground. When we go there, that's one thing. Obviously, we'll team up with the people, and if you guys are going, we can definitely put you in touch with the ground teams. But there's already a lot of effort that's being put into, you know, how to bridge those communication gaps, how to establish these relationships, you know, how to motivate the farmers in taking up organic farming and help them understand, you know, the policies.
Absolutely. I was just saying that I was just what I meant to say is maybe we can just think of some other strategy for situations like this where we don't have ground team, but then we have someone. So perhaps we can bring out a structure like, okay, one person, even if it's here, is able to organize some people, and then he or she organizes a call, then we can start the discussion that way. And
So actually what we could do is actually just create a FAQ about anybody NRIs who wants to interact with people, the important people, as Suresh was mentioning, who are the key players in the village. And you make a note of that and then get their phone numbers and you want to directly call them. Then what could be an FAQ? That would be nice. Probably get Vijay to review that, so that what makes sense and what doesn't when they talk. And also, we should also create a list of people who could stop by within, like, you know, one, two districts away, who could always come and give this information. So basically, we were speaking with a lady in Mehbubnagar called Lavanya. She's an organic farmer. She completely farms. When they were doing with the chemical fertilizers, they got 11 rupees, I guess, one time when they sold their crop off in 14 acres. So later on, they went to organic with Shubesh Palekar and all. Now, she grows, what do you call, the Kankambaram Pulu, like the organically, and they fetch, that alone fetches her $50,000, 50,000 rupees. And what she does is gets all her produce into a truck or small truck or something, and she has a couple of apartments who completely buy from her. She brings them, sells to those people, and goes back. That's it. And she's a huge success. So she's ready to come to any village. She'll stay there for a week. She'll teach people everything about what you're saying, all the organic methods of creating fertilizers and pesticides out of the, you know, manure from cows and whatnot. And she'll stay there. So there's a whole bunch of people. If you can develop a database and resource list, then we can always identify who would come by. There's so many other people who want to help with the zero-budget farming, right? They just give the first seeds completely free, and then they'll take it back after 3-4 years when the land is completely organic. They take twice of that amount or something back.
Sure,
which is
sure.
Very fair. So maybe FAQs for NRIs to interact locally. And some of these people review what questions to talk, what not, how do we get that 20 people or 25 people interested. Mm-hmm. And probably that is an NRI guy who is really interested, who's going to do it. If you give the job to a local guy, probably one or two people are excited about it. But so there's so many disoriented youth or disoriented farmers there. So mm-hmm. I don't think so anyone would be able to pull up like 20, 30 people. So I think it should be a job of an NRI or someone locally in Hyderabad or
I think, as Suresh mentioned earlier, like I was reading a little about like RSA, right, Swarajyavedika, and also CSA. Mm-hmm. They have mm-hmm. like a good ground team. Like, they have like paid volunteers who actually go to the villages. They already established like the ground teams there. So if you want like more, rather than spending more time on recreating that structure, I would suggest like working with them. Because right now, like what IFAR Farmers has been doing recently, I think as far as I know, like they have been able to implement so many things by working with CSA and RSA rather than like building our own network, because that will save you like a lot of time and money in terms of like getting things done, I guess.
Okay, guys, what I'll do is I'll create an email and put in some of this one we discussed about, like Rice Swarajyavedika in Telangana. I'll be in touch with Suresh or Srikar and some contacts in Kadapa, and I'll just email it to the groups we have, and we can consolidate, we can add to that, and then when we are ready, when we all concur that we have all the information we need, then then we can use that as an FAQ.
Is that Malik?
This is Kishan here.
Oh, hi, Kishan. Okay, Kishan.
Okay, sounds good.
All right. So I guess we are whatever our takeaways that we discussed, we can focus on that. And then in the next call, we can maybe take a poll, or you guys can just say on the event page, we have two topics that we wanted to cover. One was, what can NRIs do over here in the U.S. in terms of, addressing the farming crisis? That was one topic. And the other topic was the technology intervention in helping the, in help dealing with the farming crisis.
What was the next topic?
The technology intervention was one.
Okay.
And the other one was...
What can NRIs do?
Right. What can NRIs do from here? What is NRIs' role in this preventing the farming crisis or dealing with the farming crisis?
Okay. Okay.
So also, Suresh, I think, those are great topics. I believe we could probably discuss either of them. Both are excellent. And another thing, Suresh, is I would like to be, I'm interested in that, what is the Rajiv Gandhi thing that they're promising 150 days now or something?
Mm-hmm.
So I would like to see what are all, I would like to participate. And if I get more information, I can get in that list together, where all in South India that's happening, or it's particularly in Andhra Pradesh or Telangana, something like that.
Okay.
No, it's actually, it is across entire
India, right?
Central
government thing, I guess.
Yeah, it is a scheme for the unemployed youth, you know, how to involve them. So they came across this particular scheme. And now, because of the drought, in the drought-ridden areas, now they've increased it to 150 rupees per day for the work they've done. So it is like, yeah.
Is it 150 rupees or the number of days they have increased?
No, 150 rupees per day.
No, 150 days. They have, so originally the NREGS was covering 100 days, guarantee 100 days. But in the drought-prone areas, they're saying that they have increased to 150 days.
Yeah,
and,
for those days, yeah. I mean, that it is a, direct, I mean, it is like same, for 100 days per day, 100 rupees they get. Now it is since 150 days, but still they are getting only 100 rupees per day. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay, that's good. So So two things that at least I have noticed in like talking to 100 people from Telangana in the last 14 months is there's a lot of talk. We can gain a lot of knowledge, and unfortunately, we'll become experts here. And then rather than doing anything on the ground, is one whatever you call that we might fall into. Exception of Suresh and his team and the way they're doing stuff, I guess. But one of the things I've noticed is this, if we can narrow down into our village, our mandal, or anything else that we can make an impact on, maybe that might be the best. So maybe I'll start off with what makes sense for Nalgonda, my district, and then I keep expanding so that I still have the data for everybody else who wants to do it. But if we are from a district or a mandal or a village, we rather want to focus on that one somehow so that there'll be some change on the ground as well, impactful change, something that I was hoping and requesting everyone.
Yeah, I think that's a good suggestion. In fact, it makes sort of practical sense as well to take it down to that level where we believe we have access to that place and see what is being done, what needs to be done, and it becomes a lot more easier that way.
Yeah, I think the bottom line is like there are certain resources where like IFR farmers or RSA or CSA, they have like the tools that we can use. But the bottom line, it comes down to like how much can you contribute, whether your time or money. So I would really focus on that. And then once we have that ready to get it done, I think we have enough people on the ground whom we can approach. So as you said, like if we can start with your village, your mandal, your district, that would move things faster, I guess. Yep, that makes sense.
Yeah.
I agree with you to that degree that we don't have to reinvent the wheel. We can learn from them. But to a large extent, the way they operate are in limited districts only. Like Raistu Sarvaswaraja Vedika, I believe it's mostly in Mahbub Nagar and closer places. So every place, every district has their own like local organic farmer expert, local organic, like, you know, farmer approach expert, like, you know, anything, like farmer distress.
The one thing is that I actually have to drop in a couple of minutes. One thing is, so the people who are working in these areas, right, in the organic farming or zero budget farming or any of these people are all like well connected with each other.
Right.
They have to be, because that's how they, you know, gain knowledge from each other. That's how they keep interacting, sharing, and leveraging each other's expertise. So if I say that there is some expertise that's needed in Anantapur, the word quickly spreads, and people from either RSV go there, or people from Maharashtra, they can go there. Someone from Uttar Pradesh, they can go there. And I've found that all these guys know each other. When I'm talking to these individuals and I take the other person as the reference, they already know that person.
Awesome. Right.
So
that's really
it's
good.
It's a small world. It's easy to get connected. With your suggestion, right? If you realize that in your mandal, in your village, there is work that needs to be done, all we need is you let us know, and then I'm sure there will be more than a few people who will be willing to, provided there is enough commitment from the village. That's one thing
right.
I keep emphasizing. If that is there, then the rest of things we can work to make it happen.
Yep. So I think from a organic farming expansion, knowledge expansion, I think they're very, very dedicated. As you're saying, they come to any length and distance and teach it. But I was more referring to like some of the things, like, you know, this few MB Foundation, someone, they have a limited resources and they don't expand that much until they get additional funds, is what I've observed. But that's not the case with organic. So just to be look out for that. But great, great to know. And I think we'll be making more progress on that front.
All right. Thank you all for the call.
Thanks,
Suresh.
Thank you for running it. It's really
thanks,
great.
Guys.
Thanks, Shrikar.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.
Good night.